Hello adventurers and welcome. My name is Ken and I appreciate you being here with Flying Orcs today to try and get your scene set up in your maps. Now what a scene is effectively it is just your map structure, so you can use it for battle maps or maybe stores or whatever you'd like to set up, towns and different things. For this, what we'll be doing is, this is going to be a two-part series. The first part is going to be about moving your map in, importing it effectively. Actually setting the grid size to be correct and the actual map itself to be ready to go so you can put things on the map. I'm also going to show you how to get a few maps and stuff like that, and we'll go through that together. The other side of it is then part two will be about how to set up walls and lighting and stuff like that, and I'll explain to you why you can't actually do that first, usually anyway, in most cases. I'll show you all of that now when we set up the map, but for part one at least we're going to get the map set up. For part two then we'll do the more complicated niche stuff like different lights and stuff like that, the different walls and things. So for now, there's a few places you can get scenes if you don't already have one. You can make them yourself using something like Dungeon Draft or Dungeon Alchemist. Those are great pieces of software to set up scenes, and they come pre-configured, which means that when you export the scene, you can just import it then into Foundry and it has like all the lighting and the walls and everything's already done, which is amazing. The other ways are you can get them through Patreons and Reddits and stuff like that, through the subreddit and stuff like that. You can get them on a ton of the D&D subreddits, but what I do is usually I go to FoundryVTT, type in battle map, top of all time, make sure you're searching by FoundryVTT and you'll get a bunch of stuff. A bunch of amazing stuff too. So for example, the Enron Beauty one here is about pre-configured maps. Like I said, those are ones with all the details already in. You can get a bunch of packs from them that have a bunch of stuff, or like just different individual maps. What I've done is I've also created a post on Patreon earlier today. The map I'm going to be using in the tutorial today, I've attached to Patreon. I made it myself in Dungeon Draft. So you can always use that if you want to and bring that across and use that for your guide for your setup. You can also use it in your own games if you want to. That's perfectly fine. What we'll be doing is I'll be showing you the entire guide. Both videos is going to be using that map. So you feel free to use it if you want. It's a free post on Patreon. I'll include the link below. Anyone can access it. You don't need to subscribe to do that. So, okay, let's get started. So what we'll do is we'll create our scene. I'm going to call this the Abu Inn because that's what I'm going to be using today. The basics of the Abu Inn will cover things like the scene name, which is what you see over here, the navigation name, which will be over here, and permissions. So permissions is all players are GM only. All players is if all players can see it and access it. They can click on it to activate it. So if they can see it, they can go there. GM only means that only you can see it. And if you right click it, you'll get a bunch of options, usually when it's ready to go anyway, which will be to activate the scene so it brings everybody to it, or to preload the scene, which means that before your players go there, it will load it. However, whatever is here in the navigation name is what it will tell them it's loading. So if you don't want them to know they're going to the Abu Inn, for example, you can just say, like a spell, that would be great. You can say unknown, and then it would just say loading or preloading unknown. And then when you activate it, it'll bring them in and they'll be like, oh, we're at the Abu Inn, amazing. There you go. Well, hopefully they'll be like that. In my D&D games, they might be a bit more pessimistic than that, but you know, we'll see. Background image, this is... So in the background, you've got your things like if I built a small town, for example, and I put a bunch of buildings in that the players could explore, they were open buildings. I would put them in, I'd put in the furniture, and then I'd have my main street, and then the foreground image would be the rooftops of those buildings. So in my foreground, I would have the various rooftops that the players, as they approached the building, the rooftop would disappear so that they could see inside, and then they would move back out, go around, and then the rooftop would reappear. Meaning that from far away, they wouldn't be able to see inside, but from up close, they would. It also depends on line of sight and visions and stuff, but we'll go through that. What you can also do is, what I really like doing just for an extra bit of flair, is in the foreground image, I'll put the treetops, but in the background image, underneath where those treetops would normally be, I would put tree stumps. So it means that when they walk close to a tree, the tree looks like it's also doing what the rooftops do, giving them a feeling of immersion that the higher levels will come down for them as they walk through. I quite like that. Background color, that is whatever you want it to be. I'll set it to black just to show you. It's just the background of the map itself. Initial view position. So this is the view position that's displayed the first time you load the map. So if you've been on the map and you've moved around and stuff like that, like in the current session, it will bring you to wherever you just left off. But if, let's say you guys stop playing this week, you come back next week, whenever everybody opens the map, it'll go back to that initial view position. So wherever you have that set, usually it's very zoomed out and you can see the entire map. So I like to zoom it in first. Grid is the type of grid that's on the map. We'll cover that actually now in a second. Lighting is if your tokens can actually see, so token visions. So I usually have that set to yes. Fog expiration means that there's this kind of really dark fog across the map, so the players can't see anything until they've been in that spot. It's fog of war, effectively. The way I used to mimic that in my like more manual games was with like a sheet of paper or something. You'd block it off, but in this case, you actually have digital effects of fog of war. If anyone plays the old Red Alert games and stuff like that, it was the same thing. So moving through fog of war, that type of thing. Unrestricted vision range means that they're not limited to just, so let's say they've got 30 foot of dark vision or dim vision. Will they be able to see beyond that during the day or something? Unrestricted vision range usually means it's like daytime or something, you know? Darkness level, I can show you this more practically in a moment, but 0 means daytime, 1 means nighttime. You can actually kind of even see the screen dim and go bright in the background. Vision limitation threshold is, so if I put this at 0.35, but the darkness threshold is at 0.3, then people can see. If I go to 0.4, they can't. Ambiance is just, if you've got a journal entry, so if you've got over here a journal, so if we had created a journal called it Abu In, we could click on it here, link it, and we could, so for the scene playlist, you can select your music playlist from here and then select the playlist sound you want to play. So every time you load the map, it just automatically goes in. So for example, if you have tavern ambiance in the background and then you load up the the ambiance scene playlist and then the ambiance sound effect for just tavern shuffle or whatever like that, and then immediately when you load the tavern, a bunch of people sound like they're moving around, it just makes it more immersive and you don't have to click on 1,000 things to get things done, you know. Weather effects of course are leaves, rain, snow. You can get more of these in the form of modules, but effectively just means, does the weather start straight away when the scene comes on, or will you activate it yourself on the left? So what we'll do is, with the background image and foreground image, what we want is the background image. Now, if you're saving my map from Patreon, for example, or one of the maps from the subreddit, what you'll want to do is right-click Foundry and click Show Data Location. That kind of, it's an option there that allows you to see your data. So you go into that and it will take you to your data folder. You go straight into the data folder and you'll see this kind of layout. Now, mine has got a lot more information, like deck of many or whatever, but there should be a basic infrastructure of stuff like this. And part of this is worlds will definitely be there. You can also set up a section for maps, or they may already be there as well. But I will use worlds for this. And I go to my world and I've got Abu in here. The reason I do this is because I make a lot of maps for my different worlds and I like to have it laid out in a way that I can remember where each map is for each world and it doesn't get all cluttered by the fact that I've got like 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 games going. I don't want all my worlds to be in one place. All my maps to be in one place. So I put them usually in the worlds. So what I'll do is I'll click on Abu in here and then I'll save these changes. It will tell me that it's going to change the dimensions of the scene. That is perfect. That's perfectly fine. That's what we want. Now, we have our Abu in. So the first thing I'll do is, if I want to, for example, I'll right click this, click configure, and I'll change my initial view position so that it's right here. Every time I load in, this is what I'm going to see. Now, if we go up into the top left corner here, you can see that the Foundry grid, which is these straight lines here, are not the same as my map grid, which is these dotted lines here, for example. So what that means is that if I was to put, let's take Reno down, for example, he's not going to fit into the grid that we have pre-designed for the map. He's just going to fit onto the Foundry grid, and we need to fix that. So how we go about doing that is you right click and click configure and you go to your grid settings. Now there are a ton of settings here. Basic idea of what they all do is, this is the grid size. So how big is the square here? So this square right here, how big is it? So this one is exactly 100. The dimensions of the image, this is automatically pre-designed by whichever image you import. Padding percentage is how much it kind of fills the side. So it pushes everything down by a certain percentage or up by a certain percentage. This is really good, actually. I've noticed that if I put a bunch of walls and structures down, but then eventually change my image size like this, or my grid size, so there's an image size in here I'll show you in a moment. If I change my image size, it's good to kind of move it with a bit of padding sometimes. Offset just means, so like if I was to, I'll actually show you that in 1 second, but if I was to offset the lines, it would move my square down within the confines of this bigger square. I'll show you that now. Grid scale and color, like how big is the distance in each grid and what color is the grid and stuff. I wouldn't worry too much about that. We're going to control that now in a second anyway. So If you click on this ruler here, this is the grid configuration tool. What this allows you to do is it gives you big red grids, which is great. So you can actually see very clearly where your grid is. You can change it from gridless, which means there's no grid at all showing up except the one that's already pre-built onto the map. You can change it to square, which is what we're using here, or hexagonal rows if you're playing your games that way as well, or columns. What we'll be doing is in square. So the background image scale, this is what I was talking about with padding. Sometimes you may want to make your background image bigger. So if I change it to like 1.4, you'll see that the image actually changes dramatically in size. So the grids that now were almost fitting into one have now gone absolutely huge. So now I could fit four grids into one instead of what it was just a second ago, which is just 1.5 grids. Do you see that? So if I was to change this to any number, I could change it to 2 if I want to. It makes the overall map absolutely huge. And you can see that 9 of my normal Foundry grids now fit into one square, which makes the map huge. It's offset as well. So you can do your padding and your offset again to bring everything up. That's what the whole point of padding and offset are. So for offset, for example, padding will bring this in. So like padding will bring the map up and down. That's what it does. And then the offset will bring... So if I was to offset this by, say, 5, just something small, you'll see that it's actually moving the overall lines across the image. You see that? So if I go to 50, it moves everything quite dramatically, X and Y, so up and down and left and right. It brings everything dramatically across. Now, what I'll do is I'll set this back to 0 and I'll set this back to 1. There we go. So we're back on the defaults. So it almost fits, but not quite. So what we can see here is that this square fits like most of the way through this square. Do you see that? So this one square here is huge, and this one square here is just almost fitting, but not quite. What we can also see is that this line goes halfway through the second square. So that would be a 0.5. So 1.5. So what we would do here is we will go to grid scale, which is about 100, which is 1. 1.5 is 150. And now that fits. Do you see that? So those grids now fit perfectly. Well, my map was designed to be this way, but you can get them sometimes where they're a little bit off. So 150 may not fit, or it may need to be 147 or something. What you'll find is sometimes the maps are a little bit out of balance as well when you download them from certain websites. So it's better to get them from specific places like Patreon or even the Foundry subreddit where they're optimized for something like Foundry. Because if you get them and they're like cropped or cut in weird ways, or you get them where like half a square is there, it becomes a big problem with trying to get these scales correctly. But you can offset as much as you want. So like, let's say that this was the perfect size, but it was off by a little bit. So like, I don't know, I'll be really dramatic and say it's off by 46 and 45, sure. So you can see like, look, we know that the red grid is the same size, but it's about tweaking it to find out how to get it in to fit the match the each square. So I could always do it this way. I could go say, right, 150X. That was actually perfect, but let's say I did this at 120 and then 130. I can see that it's getting closer. 140 and 150. There we go. So, you know, 150 fits. So we can just set this to 50 and see how that gets on. We can set it to 100 because we know it's far away and we know that it's going to be 150 anyway. So we can just skip to that part and I'll just show you that it jumps straight down and it fits. Do you see that? Now, in my case, this also fits on 0, so I will do that. But you can basically offset if you know that the square is the right size, but it's still not quite aligning. That's where offset position comes in really handy. So you save your changes. It will refresh your map. And what we can see is that we have our map grid fitting perfectly. It's very, very smooth. And we could take our Reno, for example, bring him down to the map. And now he has his line of sight, which is quite large because he was standing here earlier, so he still remembers that foggy section. If I had lighting here and stuff, you'd be able to see where all the lights were. If I put walls up, however, you wouldn't be able to see through these walls, just these windows, but not the walls. And that's what I'm going to show you in our next video. So what we'll do is we'll stop it here for the moment. That's effectively how you get your map set up and ready to go. Now, when it comes to offsetting and stuff, you want to do all of this before you add anything like lighting, like walls, like any of that. Because if you, let's say I added all my lighting first and then I changed it so the grid fits, this light would be like way over here. This light would be way over here. It actually adjusts all the walls and all the stuff that's on the map to then fit the new grid system, which means that it shoots it off in some random, well, not a random direction. It shoots them usually down to the right. And you then have to like move it all again and set up the walls again. So the first thing you do when you bring in a map, especially if you downloaded it off the internet, is to make sure that the grid is set up correctly so that your player fits perfectly. Once you have that done, then we move on to the juicy stuff like lighting and setting up how flickers work and like how the doors open and close for players and how to have secret doors, stuff like that. So what we'll do is I'll stop there. As I said, I will jump into the next video shortly. It should be out in a couple of days if you're watching this pretty much at launch. If you have any questions or if you have any feedback or anything at all, please feel free to leave it down below. I will do my best. If you have trouble understanding what I'm saying or if I'm going too fast, feel free to use the subtitles function as well. We make sure that all of our closed captioning is up to date and ready to go before the video even publishes. So if there's anything that you need, feel free to refer to those. Thank you so much for joining me today. I really hope this helps. We're getting pretty close now. We have maps to finish, then how to do combat, and then how to use items and how to import those and set those up. Once that's done, then that'll be basically Foundry's 0 to 100 guide done, and we will be jumping into how specific modules can change and impact your game. But if there's any other tutorials or series that you would like, feel free to let me know. I'm also going to be jumping into ones for things like D&D Beyond and how that interacts with different features of Foundry and stuff as well, and other series that have very little to do with Foundry as well, but more to do with Dungeons, Dragons, and that kind of thing. But if you have any questions, any problems, or if you want any tutorials or guides, feel free to let me know down below, and I will put them on the list. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful day.